So this is a gap region as depicted in this plot diagram. The outer circle represents the inner boundary of the FHE model. The inner circle represents the atmosphere altitude. Between the two, this is a gap region. Inside it, we assume the magnetic field lines to be perfectly conductive, so that it allows for the perfect mapping of the electric potential. So the zero potential drop is assumed along the magnetic field lines. So these two models are coupled by mapping along the magnetic field lines of the electric potential and the field line currents. So the fundamental equation of the MI system is this one, derived from current continuity, which means that the field line currents from the hemisphere is closed by the atmosphere current, which is determined by this activity. So this capital sigma is actually the height integrated conductivity. We call it the conductance, which is a very important element in the MI system, which I will discuss later. So the second part, I will review some recent advances in the modeling and understanding of the electrodynamics of the MI coupling. For each of these areas, I will show one example for demonstration. Firstly, the Bayside hemisphere coupled with the atmosphere. So the primary driver for this coupling is actually solar wind trend and changes. So here I will talk about the changes in solar wind dynamic pressure, like a sudden increase in the solar wind dynamic pressure. So from observations like Superdon observations, they often detect convection cells, which are two cells convecting from Bayside to a Nightside, following a sudden increase in the solar wind dynamic pressure. This is called the traveling convection vertices. peak around midnight, but for eastward peak, it is almost zero at the same location. So in 1973, McFarlane proposed a model that connects the tail current with an atmosphere to this region 1 cm inland current. So it forms a wedge shape, so we call it substorm current wedge, SCW. Using this model, actually, it explains very well on what was observed on the ground. From this model, it can be expected a certain peak, the peak at midnight for the northward E, but for the eastward component, it is zero at midnight. So this model, although very simple, but explained a lot of the observations very well. And using our simulations, we try to understand what causes the field line currents from SCW. So Yakin's simulation from 2011, they found that the BBFs from the tail connection, they connect towards the tail, towards the earth, and to twist the field lines and cause the vortices over there. And the pressure increase the front of these BBFs, they actually create the region 1 cm line current. So this is the opposite polarity of the field line current. This has been on consensus for a long time that BBF creates the region 1 cm line current. But recently, they also found that on earthward side of this region 1 cm field line current, there's another pair of field line current, which is in the opposite polarity, in region 2 cm. So they found that there's another set of field line current in front of the traditional region 1 cm. Similar result is found in Yang's simulation in 2012. With the ASEAN recurrent model, we found that following a bubble injection from high altitude down to low latitude, a region 2 cm field line current appears at low latitude. And in the high latitude, that is region 1 cm. So it is, seems like there's a new pair of field line current in the SCW. So recently, in 2015, Capco updated the SCW picture by adding one more field line current in front of this original region 1 cm. This blue, or this red wedge is a new field line current in the region 2 cm. This is a new picture of the SCW. The third area I'd like to talk about is the inner magnetosphere coupled with the atmosphere. Particularly on the substorm, sub-aurora relations chain, the steps. Steps refer to the large westward convection flows, midward of the dusk electron aurora precipitation boundary. It is usually associated with large electric field. Can impact on the plasma sphere and also the atmosphere dynamics. This figure from Millstone Hill radar shows that the steps here with larger velocity is usually accompanied with the electron density trough. And this kind of phenomenon appears off the equitable boundary of the electron precipitation as shown by the EMSP operation. A popular generation mechanism for steps is proposed by Southwood and Wolf in 1987. So they found that they proposed that the main current in the inner magnetosphere, the pressure gradient would induce the region 2 field line current. And it is induced around the ionospheric plasma shielding boundary, which is indicated by this circle. But the electron aurora boundary is at a higher latitude, so it is misaligned from the ion plasma shielding boundary. That means that the region 2 field line current actually flows into a region with a lower conductivity. In order to close this region 2 field line current with a high latitude region 1 current, it requires a large electric field. This large electric field results westward drift in cross B direction. So that is what observed as a SEPS. And actually, the drift in the ionosphere would heat up the atmosphere and increase the recombination rate and decrease the electron density, so decrease the conductivity. That is a positive feedback to the steps that would amplify the electric field in this region. So the steps will be amplified. So in order to understand the relationship between the region 2 field line current, the low conductance, and the steps, Chen et al. 2008 conducted a IRA simulation using this artificial, by putting artificially lower conductance equitable of this aurora boundary. They found that with such a low conductance, the steps amplitude, the steps magnitude is significantly amplified compared to the acceptable system. But at the same time, we can see that improvements are needed because the disappointment do exist in many aspects. So next question is, what needs to be improved? So please to my third session, the challenges. I'm not going to talk about everything that needs to be improved, but I will only touch on the conductance that that is being improved and needing improved in my model. Because it represents the center of the chain in the feedback effect. So it has come to a consensus that the conductance is actually one of the most important elements in the MS operation. And it can determine and control the dynamic directions. So the diagram on the right side actually shows that the ionization in the ionosphere determines the conductivity, which further determines the electric field. And the electric field actually plays a very important role in the plasma transport in the next year and the subsequent wave dynamics. The latter can further scatter the particles down to the ionosphere, producing the particle precipitation, which further changes the ionization and the conductivity over there. So you can see the conductance actually acts as an interplay between the ionosphere and the magnetosphere. And it represents the center of the feedback, the chain of the feedback effects. So in order to more self-consistently account for these effects and the feedback effects, and we need to understand firstly, how does the conductance influence the MS system? So next I'm going to show you a few examples on the impact of conductance for the underlying sphere system. The first example is in the conduction estimation. So let's go to 2014, there are a few experiments with different kinds of conductance pattern. They found that with a uniform conductance like this one, the convection pattern in the tail in the equator of the magnetosphere is very symmetric. But when they use a causal conductance, including the auroral precipitation and also the side UV radiation, the flow pattern in the night side is not symmetric. The flow speed on the dust side is the larger than the downside. And then they also try the artificial conductance pattern like this. The X line is actually tilted on the tail, and the flow channels are not symmetric. So this indicates that the distribution of the conductance pattern in the atmosphere is very important in regulating the magnetosphere dynamics. On the other hand, the magnitude of the conductance also matters in determining the system. So for example, back in 2005, they simulated two simulations with different values of conductance. This kind of simulation uses uniform conductance, by the way. So they found that the shape of the location of the both main pulse and the bow shell, they highly depend on the atmospheric conductance, such that using a larger conductance, the main pulse is very close, much closer to the Earth compared to the other things. So this may affect the side of the magnetosphere. Other example using the different conductance the values is in reading 2015 simulation. They found that the flow channels from night side can penetrate to different distances with different conductance. For example, using this larger conductance, the flow channels do not stop, do not penetrate as deep as the one in the other case with smaller conductance. And they also analyzed the Pi2 conditions inside L of 8. They found that in the model with a smaller conductance like the LFM model, there are more conditions inside L of 8. On the other hand, the UCLA model with a larger conductance, there are not so many conditions inside the screen. The last example is on the magnetic perturbations. So Huntington 2017 recently found that the magnetic perturbations on the two hemispheres on the conjunctive locations, they behave very similar, although it is during the solstice, where we would expect the solar UV radiation are very asymmetric. But we found the behavior from the oscillations are very similar, including the magnitude and the trends in the LT direction, MLT direction. In the latitude direction. So they conducted two simulations using the conductance from solar UV only, and another simulation with the auroral precipitation included. Now they found that with the solar radiation only, the perturbation on the ground from these two conjunctive locations, they disagree very much from each other. It is expected because the conductance is not symmetric on the ground, on the ionosphere. And then in the second simulation, when the auroral conductance is included, thought of first principle. So the first one is the empirical formula. The formula one used with the Robinson's formula, which relates the precipitation flux with the conductance. The second one is the first principle, the transport code, which solves the vertical profile of the animation in the atmosphere and the vertical profile of the conductivity. The third one is the most comprehensive one. It includes the atmosphere-thermosphere circulation by including the circulation fields. So examples include the CTI, TE, the TITCM, and the GITM. All those models, they have a common input, which is the particle precipitation as a driver to determine the aurora conductance. So our next question is, how do we specify the precipitation in our models? There are different tools. One is dimensionally parameterization. The other one is the kinetic calculation. So next, I will briefly talk about these two methods. First one is the energy parameterization for the precipitation. Example is in the LF model. So in June 2015, they developed the electron precipitation model in the convection model based on the embedded kinetic theory giving the source-related electron distribution. So basically, they took the parameters from the energy model like temperature, the density, and specify the precipitation flux with those kind of equations. And they found the precipitation, the pattern of the precipitation from the diffuse and discrete precipitation is actually agreed very well with the Ovation Prime as described about. So using this type of precipitation, they import to the Robinson's empirical model to calculate the performance. And we know that the precipitation process actually is a kinetic process. So actually, we needed to use a kinetic wave to determine the precipitation flux. It's more physics-based. So this can be done in the Rinker model, where the distributed function is solved. So for this type of equation, the last term actually represents electron loss with the wave particle interactions. So the precipitation can be determined from this last term. Example is in the RCME model, who uses a lifetime to determine this last term. So in their model, they specify certain electron lifetimes based on some wave particle interactions and determine the precipitation flux. So this is an example showing on the atmosphere altitude. They map down the precipitation down to the atmosphere altitude. This is what the precipitation energy flux look like. And then again, once they got the precipitation flux, they import to the empirical model, the Robinson's model, to calculate the conductance. And top and the second panel is a Hall and Peterson conductance calculated by the Robinson's model. Similar method with the lifetimes is also in the Heidi model from the University of Michigan. So Plumbo 2017, they actually investigated the effect of electron lifetimes on the conductance. They found that the aurora conductance, those are the aurora conductance with different electron lifetimes. When the electron lifetime increases, the conductance decreases. And the electric field is largely impacted by the different types of electron lifetimes. So this tells us that the atmospheric dynamics is highly dependent on the lifetime specification in the Rinker model. Now, in addition to using the lifetime approach to solve the loss term, there's another way to solve this physics of this universe region, one third of quantum physics is the oxygen outflow. So recently there are many studies being conducted to study the effect of outflow on the atmospheric system. So I'm going to show you a few examples on the impact of the outflow. First one, the magnetic reflection rate will be reduced when we have this outflow is triggered. So the reflection rate is greatly reduced. Second, the carbon monoxide may be triggered on the cracks when we have a large amount of oxygen going into the atmosphere. So, for example, when we improve the atmosphere outflow, the regional energy density will be significantly enhanced compared to a case where the oxygen is not included. For example, the salty oxidation may be induced when we have the oxygen included. Finally, the tail dynamics may be altered when we have this example is by June 2015. They found that the plasma molecule may travel towards the Earth when the oxygen is included. If it is not included, the plasma molecule may transport to Earth. So the oxygen outflow may impact greatly on the atmosphere dynamics, and we need to include this gap between physics in our global models. The second example is on the parallel actually. So as I said earlier, typical models assume the zero potential job. Electric field, the parallel electric field is not existing in our model. But actually, we know that in the region of the Aurora region, especially with the upward turbulent current, there is a parallel electric field. And that has been ignored in our model for a long time. So recently, in our model again, for the first time, they have implemented this parallel electric field in our model. And they found that the possible potential is slightly decreased. And the injection, the outflow injection speed out of this X-line location is enhanced compared to the case when the electric field is not included. Another fact is that the X-line is closer to the Earth when we have this parallel field. So as you can see, all this electric field, parallel electric field can also impact on the atmosphere dynamics. This is a new target and deserves further investigation. So to summarize my part of the challenges, in general, in my opinion, many assumptions in my coupled model need to be revisited. So those quiz actually summarize what I have just talked about. So first one is the thing from the shift. Such kind of assumption is not a property anymore. Instead, we need to use a 3D atmosphere thermosphere to cover the whole atmosphere system. Empty gap region. We assume that empty, but we know it's not actually empty. Instead, we need to include the oxygen outflow physics in the gap region to solve it and then couple to our global models. The third one is the potential assumption we use in our global model. We know that the parallax could actually exist in some region, and we need to investigate the effect of that, especially for the region, especially in the Aurora region. Finally, the last one is the inner atmosphere. Here I want to emphasize the microfluidics, which is blue particle interactions. Because this one is related to our particle precipitation, which contributes to the conductivity in the atmosphere. So that is in the center of our black effect. So, and of course, there are many more aspects that need to be improved as well. But here I will just talk about these four of these. So to summarize my talk, atmosphere system is a fully coupled, complicated and dynamic system which requires a self-consistent treatment in the models. And we have made a lot of progress in the modeling and understanding of the system. And also the challenge lies in the fulfillment of the self-consistency within the model. And it is not a small short-term project, but a community-wide and long-term project. Especially, I want to emphasize these three points. The 3D atmosphere thermosphere model is needed in the global models. And the gap region should be, gap region physics should be included as well. And for the atmosphere physics, especially the international physics, like the particle interactions, need to be considered in our couple as well. So that is what I want to tell you. Thank you very much for your attention.
other questions?